is a show unlike any other we've done before, because even though it focuses on our pet issues of independent directors and corporate governance, it does not attempt to judge. Instead, today we try and understand the gap between expectations and reality, the role that shareholders expect independent directors to play, and in reality, what the scope of that role is. Hello and welcome to The Firm. Today we bring you the truth about independent directors from the perspective of three battle-hardened veterans, Hari Shah, Suresh Talwar and Saugata Ray. Located in a lane near Mumbai's Horniman Circle is one of India's oldest law firms, Crawford Bailey. The over 100-year-old firm may have outlived this space. But time has not shrunk the stature of its 80-year-old senior partner. In the world of commercial law, R.A. Shah is an institution unto himself. And as independent director for more than 30 years, his is a voice that is rarely taken lightly. When I talk to him about board politics, his response is careful and yet candid. How have you seen the role of independent directors change over the last 30 years?
Leopard seldom changes its spots. There are promoters, dyed in the wool, who have got the least respect for laws and regulations. They have used the new regulations and the new regime of having an audit committee and independent directors as an umbrella and a protection as and an excuse and cover for what goes on in some of those companies.
That's why he says he is very selective in his choice of directorships.
I am mostly involved in multinational companies and their subsidiaries, where most strategic decisions are taken extraterritorially in the headquarters of that multinational company concern, and they come up for reporting, ratification, and knowledge and information of the local board, whether it is the local managing director or whether it is local independent director or other directors. Yes, the managing director participates in that decision-making process when he goes abroad or they come here. But so far as other directors are concerned, their role is rather limited. This is a fact of life which pervades all through multinational companies.
But why is it, Mr. Shah, that you have preferred to be on boards of multinational companies? Is it because as a lawyer, you understand that in a sense, because of all these safeguards that you've spoken about, limits the potential liabilities that you may have to face? Is it because you have
a deep-seated mistrust
of Indian promoters?
Let me explain to
why
you.
Why is it that
my role? I am mainly involved in industries which are highly regulated. Pharmaceutical industry is probably amongst the most regulated industry in India, whether it is price control, whether it is in licensing, patents, and various other regulatory issues. It requires highly specialized expertise to be able to advise a pharmaceutical company.
I understand. So they value your presence on board very highly.
There are few such specialists who have got that expertise in the pharma industry.
I understand that.
And the same holds good for chemical industry, companies like BASF, Clariant, and so on. FMCG industries,
Procter & Gamble,
Colgate, and some of these other FMCG companies. We are advisors even to Unilever on strategic matters like their mergers and acquisitions.
Crawford & Bailey is an advisor.
We handle.
In 2010, Crawford Bailey advised Piramal Healthcare on the sale of its domestic formulations business to Abbott Laboratories for $3.7 billion. R.A. Shah was then independent director on Piramal's board. Prophet Bailey has also advised Colgate Palmolive, Asian Paints, P&G, Clarion, Pfizer India, Century Enka, Abbott India, Godfrey Phillips, Wockhardt, Lupin, Bombay Tyne, and BASF. R.A. Shah serves as independent director on the boards of all of these companies. This was pointed out by proxy advisory firm InGovern earlier this year in a report that questioned the independence of independent directors. Crawford Bailey, your firm, offers legal advisory services to those 13 companies on the boards of which you sit as independent director.
Not necessarily always.
Do you see this as a position of conflict? How would you respond to flags and questions being raised saying this is not good practice?
In some of those companies where there are possible irregularities, if the question is brought to my attention, I would unhesitatingly advise that this is not a good practice. But often what happens is, as I mentioned, the CEO and the CFO provides a certificate of total compliance, and auditors, the big four, are statutory auditors. There are internal auditors, there is an independent audit committee. I may not be involved in those companies, audit committees of those companies, but they all certify that everything is blameless, without blemish. So I don't feel that either I am doing anything improper, incorrect, or I am protecting any wrongdoing.
We talk some more, mainly about the proposals in the Companies Bill 2011. Fixed tenure, director rotation, no ESOPs in remuneration, a reduction in the maximum number of board positions a director can hold, and so on. R.A. Shah is nonchalant about most of these new curbs. In all his responses, he emphasizes that ultimately governance comes down to individual integrity.
Grievances of workers. I will not compromise my conscience. I can give you any number of examples in which I have acted as a watchdog for minority shareholders, widows and pensioners. In one company, we had a proposal emanating from a large chemical company. They wanted to pay 30% of the profits of the company as administrative charges to the head office. I put my foot down. I said, this is an outlandish arrangement, prima facie. Either you should curtail the scope of your services or you curtail the scope of the fees. And I must say that the multinational company was very responsive. The president of that company attended the next board meeting and accepted our recommendation that the total charge will not exceed 10% of the PBT of the company.
Okay.
This is only one example which I am giving. There are
several, I'm sure, in a 30-year-long career. Yes.
Many examples where we have acted as custodian of minority shareholders.
Absolutely.
And as the watchdog. So this impression that this is a collusive arrangement which is not in the best interest of the minority shareholders, I think this is a misconception.
Okay, so you're not in favor of a mandatory rotation or a fixed term. You would rather leave it up to companies, boards and their shareholders to determine how long an independent director should continue to serve the board.
You see, I believe very firmly that you can't inculcate character and independence through legislation.